saw a small but respectable number of politicians willing to break with their partisan allegiances and criticize an intimidating leader in the face of loss of life. I'm not talking about the 7 Senate Republicans who voted to convict Donald Trump, Senators Burr, Cassidy, Collins, Murkowski, Romney, Sasson, Toomey. I'm talking about the small number of Democratic officials in New York publicly expressing outrage after the latest development in the scandal surrounding New York Governor Andrew Cuomo and the numbers of New York nursing home residents who were fatally infected with COVID. You may recall the Cuomo administration last March told nursing homes, quote, "No resident shall be denied readmission or admission to the nursing home solely based on a confirmed or suspected diagnosis of COVID-19," unquote. Nursing homes took in thousands of seniors with COVID, potentially infecting thousands more, such as 89-year-old Norman Arbini. After the Cuomo directive, his family pulled him out of a nursing home after he already had gotten a fever, and Arbini died at home from COVID. Now, did he get COVID because of Cuomo's directive? We don't know for sure, but his family says it's not rocket science.
It was the absolute worst decision anybody could make in a time of a pandemic.
It's, of course, impossible to exactly ascertain how many nursing home deaths are linked to the Cuomo directive. And certainly part of the reason is that the Cuomo administration's, quote, published nursing home data reflected and may have been undercounted by as much as 50%, according to fellow Democrat and New York Attorney General Letitia James. Now, that's because infected nursing home residents who were then taken to hospitals where they died, they were omitted from the data. An interesting decision for an administration under fire for months for the nursing home directive. So Governor Cuomo, who has declined to appear on the show despite dozens of requests over the past year, including this past week, made a bad decision that may have cost lives. And then his administration hid that data from the public. Cuomo issued an executive order changing the advisory on May 10th, requiring patients to test negative before returning to their nursing homes. But that was obviously too late for those already infected. Last August, New York legislators pressed Cuomo for more information, and that's where this latest private admission, this latest development in the scandal from his secretary, Melissa DeRosa, comes in. She said that the data was withheld because, quote, right around the same time they were asking for it, President Trump turns this into a giant political football. He starts tweeting that we killed everyone in nursing homes. He directs the Department of Justice to do an investigation into us. Basically, we froze, unquote. In a public statement Friday, she also blamed the second wave of the virus for the delay in reporting. But this all fit in perfectly with what Governor Cuomo himself said on January 29th when asked about the damning report from the state attorney general.
It's not about pointing fingers or blame. It's that this became a political football, right? Look, whether a person died in a hospital or died in a nursing home, it's the people died. People died.
But where those people died and why they died and if they died because of Cuomo's March directive, that is information in the public interest. And fear of political enemies using the data against you, that's not an excuse for covering it up from the public. This was Democratic New York City Mayor de Blasio's reaction after reading about DeRosa's comments in the New York Post, which broke the story.
It's a really disturbing report. It's very troubling. We've got to know more. We now need a full accounting of what happened. Think about seniors who their lives were in the balance.
Because of your decisions, thousands of people died who did not have to die, tweeted a Democratic state legislator. This is a betrayal of the public trust, wrote another. This is criminal, said yet another. Among the governor's chief critics is New York Congresswoman Elise Stefanik, a Republican who refused to hold Trump accountable for the loss of life under his watch because of the mishandling of the pandemic or the January 6 MAGA terrorist attack at the Capitol. Stefanik, in fact, helped spread Trump's big lie. So you might find it difficult to take seriously Stefanik's stated outrage. Because if you're only upset about bad, even fatal leadership decisions and behavior based on the partisan affiliation of that leader, you're not operating from a place of righteousness, you're operating from a place of craven self-interest. Which brings us back to what happened in the U.S. Senate. yesterday, and frankly all week, the Trump defense team lied to the senators. They berated the senators. They made claims about Trump that we all know to be false, about an attack on the Senate that could have killed any of them.
Former President Trump's actions preceded the riot were a disgraceful dereliction of duty.
And yet, Republican leader McConnell and 42 other Republicans voted not guilty. Some of them denying to this day what we all saw with our eyes and heard with our ears. One wonders if anything would have been different had the mob actually achieved their desired end and, God forbid, actually hung Mike Pence. I honestly don't think so. Now, the situations with Governor Cuomo and former President Trump are obviously very different. But I will never understand the instinct that prompts someone to check the party affiliation of those acting abhorrently or indecently before figuring out how they should react. It would be nice if every elected official could behave as if indecent behavior is empirically indecent behavior, no matter the party affiliation of the one responsible. Dead bodies, they're all just as dead.